leaning to the Rotarians. Rotary Club of Madras South is not a new place to me. I have come here a couple of times before to receive an award and also to address the Rotarians, which has been put in YouTube. So I'm very happy. I'm sharing that with several of my friends. See, rainwater harvesting is talked about so much, you know, that, you know, familiarity breeds contempt. So it should not lead to that. And harvesting rain has been understood by different people in different ways. So I will probably explain to you in the next few minutes as to how we at the Rain Center have understood harvesting. We should all realize that earth gets water either from melting of ice or from rain. There is no other way the earth is going to get water. So we should be very clear on that. And most of India, barring a few states in North India, get water only from rain. And this rain, it rains only for a few days in a year, and it's called rainy days. And it is well documented in the IMD website. Every city has a particular number of rainy days. And for Chennai, it is 54. The average number of days it rains is 54. And let me also tell you that Chennai receives on an average 1.4 meters of rain, annual average rainfall, which is much more than the country's average and much more than the state's average. So strictly speaking, Chennai should not suffer for water. So we are rain rich but water starved. Probably I will discuss some of these points. In fact, when Mr. Madhu gave this the title Today and Tomorrow, I said you should add yesterday also. It should be yesterday, today and tomorrow. See, rainwater harvesting is not an option nor an alternative. People think that if you don't get water in your tap, you should harvest rain, without realizing that the water that you get in your tap is also harvested water. Not harvested by you probably, but harvested by Metro Water in some form and being supplied in pipes. Then why is it being talked so much now than ever before? If you trace the history, see, about 200 years back, right, the kings and rulers created water bodies and they harvested rain in those water bodies, and people will go and fetch water from those water bodies. People never had a source in their homes. There were community wells. I don't know. Even now I see some of them in places like Valsaravakam and Virgambakam and so on. A well on the road. So I used to wonder, what is it doing there? Then I realized that these must have been the community wells of those years. So people will go fetch water for their needs, use it, and don't bother about anything else. So they were not concerned about harvesting rain, right? But what happened in the last 100 years? Everybody started buying a plot of land, started constructing a house, dug a bore well or an open well, and therefore the responsibility of sustaining that groundwater source now shifts from the kings and rulers to the individuals. Isn't it? So that is why harvesting is being talked about much more. And now it is further shifting to the builders now. Nobody buys a plot of land, nobody buys a constructs a house. What we do is we go to a builder and we book an apartment, right? It could be an 1 BHK or a 2 BHK or a 3 BHK and so on. So buying the plot of land, constructing the high-rise building, digging a borewell is all done by the builder. And therefore, harvesting rain is also should also be the responsibility of the builder. But no builder that I know of does all this. He only constructs apartments, and then the ultimate sufferers are those who buy apartments. Yeah. So with this brief introduction about rainwater harvesting, I will now talk about how it was yesterday and how it is today, how it's going to be tomorrow. See, yesterday, right, Indians were the world leaders in rainwater harvesting. There are evidences to show that even 5,000 years back, that Indians had harvested rain. There's a place called Dholavira in Gujarat, where when they did this archaeological excavation, they found out that people had harvested rain. So 3000 BC. Indians knew that food security could be achieved by harvesting paddy and water security by harvesting rain. Right? And every part of India had its own traditional water harvesting systems. Very well documented in a book called Dying Wisdom. Unfortunately, the book is not available now. This was published by an NGO in Delhi called Center for Science and Environment. Every part, Rajasthan for example, had the best traditional water harvesting system. Because the rainfall is so less, they wanted to harvest every drop of it. People, when I go around asking people to harvest, so this is what they ask me. I tell them, only when the rain is less, your harvesting will not be good. And let me briefly tell you what was there in South India. We had the wonderful traditional water harvesting system in all the three states put together. Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. In Andhra, it used to be called Cheruvu. In Karnataka, it used to be called Kere. And in Tamil Nadu, Eri. Eri is the word. It's a Tamil word. It's basically an irrigation tank. All the three states put together, there are still 150,000 such water bodies. And they are all interconnected. When one area gets filled up, the overflow will go and fill up the neighboring villages' area, and so on. Such a wonderful system. Without Anna University existing, without IITs existing, how did people manage to do this? And Adli, there are two kinds of areas. One they call the system areas. So what happens is, the river, water flowing in the river is diverted into these water bodies on both sides of the river. And therefore, there was very little water which was getting wasted by falling into the sea. One good example of this system tank is the Veeranam area, which is helping Chennai now. Because water from Kaveri will be diverted into Veeranam. And then, now it is being supplied to Chennai, apart from being used for irrigation. So, but what is the present status? Why are we suffering so much? And to tell you something about the past few years, right? I would like to briefly tell you the role played by our Honorable late Chief Minister Jayalalitha. She was so passionate about harvesting that whenever she came to power, she did something to popularize and promote rainwater harvesting. She was a great visionary, according to me. Because none of the other chief ministers in India realized this. They don't realize even now. But she started realizing it in 94. When she came to power in 91, she made harvesting compulsory for all new buildings. And then when she came to power in 2001, once again, she made it compulsory for all old and new buildings. The famous law, which was enacted in October 2002, said every house should have harvesting. And then when the third time when she came to power in 2011, in 2013 she said an audit will have to be carried out as to what has happened. We have been talking about harvesting for the past 10 years. So what has happened? So that audit, she said, should be done only by an NGO, not by the government. She had so much faith in the government department. So that audit was given to us. We carried it out for 2 years and gave them several recommendations. And that report was lying on the table of the minister for 2 years. In the meantime, she passed away. Only now, about 6 months back, all our suggestions have been incorporated in the Tamil Nadu Building Rules 2019. And in future, when anyone wants to construct a house or apartment, they will have to follow those designs. So this was so far as yesterday was concerned. Now today, you all know we are facing a severe water crisis. Metro water supply stopped, at least in my apartment, about 6 months back. We don't get water. So we started depending on our groundwater source. We have an open well and a bore well. That has gone dry, that went dry about 3 months back. Since then we have been buying tanker loads of water. This has happened for the first time. I have been living in that complex for almost 30 years. This is the first time our well has gone dry. So this severe crisis, what are the reasons? According to me, there is one which can be attributed to nature, which was failure of monsoon in 2018. Instead of 1.4 meters, it rained only 0.86, so it was about 40% deficient. But that should not lead to such a severe water crisis. Because in 2015, you may all remember the floods that we had, when we got more than 2 meters of rain, that could not be saved. You know, that flooded the city and finally it got drained into the sea. But within 3 years, we are suffering a severe water crisis. So the other reasons are definitely man-made. We have not really taken note of the importance of rainwater harvesting. See, the key word is rainwater harvesting. There is no doubt about that. And it has to be done both by the society as well as by the state. If only we had listened to what our Honorable Chief Minister said in 2003, we will not be suffering so much. We would not have suffered such a severe water crisis. But now, people are waking up. This has come as a wake-up call. People are now more interested in doing it for themselves. See, earlier, they did it for the government's sake. Therefore, did not do a good job. See, there are two things. One, to decide to do harvesting. That's the first thing. Second thing is doing it the correct way. So I'm not going to go into all the methodologies as to what harvesting is all about. What is rooftop harvesting, what is runoff harvesting and so on. Yes, that has been talked about. But in 2003 when people implemented harvesting, the structures were wrong. The structures were not user friendly. They could not be maintained. At that time, of course, it was in an infant stage. People did not understand what harvesting was all about. They simply made a hole in the ground, inserted a PVC pipe and called it harvesting. That would have worked for a year or two. But then once the pipe gets clogged, not a drop could go down. Subsequently, now we have started replacing them with recharge wells and so on. So I will not go into those details. So the key word is rainwater harvesting. Right. And I don't know, I'm going to talk about something which is controversial, which is desalination. Now Chennai is being supplied about 100 MLD or 200 MLD of seawater, which has been converted into fresh water. We have two plants, one in Minjore, one in Nimeli, each supplying about 100 MLD water. See, that is not a very environment friendly process, nor an efficient process. Because if you take 100 liters of salt water, you get only 50 liters of fresh water, good water. The remaining 50 liters picks up more salts, almost doubles. For example, if you take desalination, if you take sea water, which is 35,000 ppm, parts per million, salinity levels, the waste, RO waste, is 70,000 ppm. And that is being put back into the sea. Is it fair? Are we doing the right thing? Is it good for the coastal ecosystem? Can fishes survive in such a high saline water? We are not bothered about all that. Secondly, it's an inefficient process. As I said, 100 liters becomes only 50 liters. Third reason is it consumes a lot of electricity. So whether we can afford to have so much electricity is a big question. The point is, on the one hand, the Greater Chennai Corporation constructs what are called stormwater drains on one side or both sides of the street and dumps the rain falling on all roads into the sea. So that is happening on one hand. And second is you take sea water and say I will make it into fresh water and give you back. So for a city like Chennai, which I said is not rain starved, there is no need for a desalination plant. That's my humble opinion. See, I can understand Saudi Arabia doing it or countries in the Middle East doing it because they don't get rain. But that is not necessary, according to me, for children. And I would also like to mention about the project that we are planning to do with the Rotary Club of Madras South. We have already visited one school in N.K. Tirumalachari Girls Higher Secondary School in Triplicane. So we have made a proposal and then that is going to be approved and work will start. The puja, Bhumi Puja, is going to take place on 3rd. So I am very happy to associate myself with the Rotary Club, and we have also seen another school in Saigapet, and I don't mind visiting a few more schools, preparing proposals and getting it funded. Because our Akash Pika Trust is also involved in some CSR activities. So a few corporates came and requested us to spend their CSR funds on water. So we have completed about 40 projects in the last 5 to 6 years. All of them are only charitable, deserving institutions. Most of them are schools. a few hospitals, a few colleges, and so on. Yeah, so finally I will talk about what should we do tomorrow. We have finished yesterday, we have talked about present. Tomorrow, both society and state should take up rainwater harvesting much more seriously. We have provided enough lip service for water and rain. We should really think about water and rain beyond words. According to me, it can no longer be just a bureaucratic exercise nor an academic exercise. It has to be a people's movement, and only then we can avoid future droughts. See, I have been telling people that future droughts are going to be much more severe than the present one. In fact, this present drought, I have not witnessed such a drought in the last 70 years that I have lived in this. Because every year the demand keeps increasing in cities, while the supply remains the same. Supply is from the rain, and demand keeps increasing, and therefore, if at all there is going to be any drought in future, it's going to be much more severe. Now, what should we do, right? If we first talk about, as individuals, what we need to do. We should try to harvest, make sincere attempts to harvest the rain falling both on rooftops in our house as well as the setback area. Because people have done good rooftop harvesting, but the rain falling all around the built up area still runs out to the street, and that is responsible for the urban floods. So we should seriously consider that that can be intercepted near the gate and put into the soil. We can still harvest it, there is a lot of scope. The rain centers we need to help people. We give only free advice. People can come to us, we are willing to give free advice to harvest. So that is the role of the individuals. Now what the government should do? There are three or four things that the government should seriously consider. One, stop indiscriminate construction of stormwater drains in the city. See, earlier they used to test the soil and decide whether to construct a stormwater drain or not. But now they are constructing it everywhere, including Vesalnagar, where the soil is so sandy. All you have to do is to keep quiet, water will percolate on its own. But there, they have come up with a stormwater drain proposal. So we strongly protested, we went to the street, the chief engineer came, had a discussion with us, and they have given it in writing that they will not construct any more stormwater drains in Vesalnagar. So this kind of indiscriminate construction of stormwater drains should be stopped. Because on the one hand, we are asked to do harvesting as individuals and residents. But the government should also play an important role. Number two, there are still, see, the city has expanded from 174 square kilometers to 426 square kilometers. In that 426 square kilometers, there are still several water bodies. Old irrigation tanks, ARs. I can give you several examples. One is, when you drive from Thorapakkam to Krompet on the Kamakshi Hospital road, you will see water bodies on both sides, which are being completely abused. There is a lot of encroachment happening, a lot of solid waste is being dumped, and also liquid waste is also being dumped. So that will have to be stopped. So instead of taking water from those water bodies, they are not taking water from quarries. I don't know why. So who's to build the cat, I do not know. And the third and most important suggestion to the government is that in both Thiruvallur and Kanchipuram, which are neighboring districts. There are close to 3,000 these areas which have lost their agricultural relevance, because those agricultural land has been converted into real estate. Right? Paddy fields have been converted into high-rise buildings. And therefore these water bodies have lost their relevance. But still they can be converted into reservoirs. See, for example, Chennai gets water from three irrigation tanks, which is called Red Hills, Cholavaram, Chembarambaram, and the fourth one is Veeram. So when you can get water from four irrigation tanks, and when there are 3,000 irrigation tanks just lying, the government has not looked into it seriously. So if only they are revived, repaired, and brought back to the past glory, then Chennai will not suffer any serious water crisis in future. So this has been the, this has been the message that we have been conveying to the government in all seminars, all workshops. Lot of resolutions are passed, given to the government. But I do not know. Now, see, for example, there is one area called Rette area in Kodathur. The government promoted a housing scheme there. How can you promote a housing scheme in a water body? And that was proudly mentioned as Rette area scheme. Area itself is a water body. And then they say we are surrounded by water during monsoon. Obviously. And now the government has realized, and now they want to recover the remaining Rette area and start supplying water to Chennai. So that's a very welcome move by the government. And there are huge areas in Ambattur, Gorattur, Madhavaram, Villivakkam. And if you go in the train, you will see huge water bodies. So I think they will have to be revived, they will have to be repaired, strengthened, remove all encroachments. If that is done, I think Chennai should not suffer a serious water crisis. And I would like to finish there. I don't mind answering a few questions if there are any. Thank you.